Looking for some new Core Set 2021 cards? Well, you can get them from our sponsor, Card Kingdom. Card Kingdom has Core Set 2021 up for pre-sale now, and you can check it out over at cardkingdom.com. Hello everyone, it's Seth, probably better known as Saffron Olive, and it's time for our first daily dose of Core Set 2021 spoilers, and oh my literal god, I don't even know what to say. This set is absurd. We're only in day one of spoiler season, and in the first few hours of spoiler season, and I think we've already seen more sweet reprints, expensive reprints, more crazy new cards in Core Set 2021 than we've seen in like the last three or four core sets combined. It is really just off the charts. I'm blown away. This set looks ridiculous. And since we have about a million cards to talk about, we better jump right into it, or this video is going to be like 2 hours long. So let's talk sweet new and even some old reprinted Core Set 2021 cards, starting with the new Planeswalker, Teferi, Master of Time. We heard a while ago that Core Set 2021 was going to be a Teferi theme set, and we got our Mythic Teferi. We haven't seen any more yet. I don't know if it's going to be like Chandra, where we get additional Teferis at like rare and uncommon, but at least Mythic Teferi is out, and that is Teferi, Master of Time. 4 mana, mono blue, 3 loyalty, a static ability where you can activate its loyalty abilities on any player's turn whenever you can cast an instant, which is absolutely absurd. +1, you get to loot, -3, you make a creature that you don't control phase out. If you're not familiar with phase out, don't worry about it. It's a weird, old, complicated mechanic that I'm honestly shocked is back in standard. But essentially, it goes into exile. It comes back on the controller's next turn at the beginning of their turn. The thing is, everything attached to it stays with it, so you don't lose your auras or equipment. So it's kind of unique in that way. And then -10, the ultimate, take 2 extra turns after this one. So if we look at these abilities, Teferi, Master of Time, it's basically Royal Scions +1 mixed with a Vision's Charm for the -3, mixed with Time Stretch for the ultimate. The big gimmick though is we can activate Teferi multiple times each turn cycle. Let's say we're just playing a normal standard game with 2 players. We play Teferi, we can, for example, loot on our turn, and then on our opponent's turn, they go to attack Teferi, we can -3 on their turn. Or maybe they don't have anything to attack Teferi, or we have good defense. We can loot on our turn, loot on our opponent's turn. So essentially, in a 2-player game, we get twice the activations. It gets even more ridiculous in Commander, and I think that is the big calling card of Teferi, is this static ability that, even though its abilities and loyalty doesn't jump off as being super excited. Only 3 loyalty, only goes up to 4 if you plus. The -3 technically takes away all its starting loyalty if you use it right away, but because you can activate it on your turn and your opponent's turn, it's much, much more powerful, I think, than it looks at first glance. On the other hand, I'm actually really happy with this Teferi. I was petrified when we heard Teferi theme set. Coming off Teferi Hero of Dominaria, dominating standard and being not all that much fun in most people's opinions, and we still have Teferi Time Raveler, dominating standard and definitely not being that much fun in like anyone's opinion, I was afraid we were going to get another miserable, highly hated Teferi. But Teferi, Master of Time, doesn't feel that way to me. This feels like a interesting and solid blue planeswalker. It loots, it gives some removal, the ultimate obviously game winning. That's how a planeswalker should be. So it feels like just a solid standard card to me, with a cool twist with the static ability, rather than a card that we're all going to be hating a few months from now, like some of the past Teferi. So as far as standard is concerned, I'm honestly not sure where Teferi, Master of Time, fits. Remember, until this fall, when Zendikar releases, we still have War of the Spark in the format, so there's a million planeswalkers there. We have other options like Narset in the 4-mana slot. Where does Teferi fit in the mix of planeswalkers? I think it's definitely good enough to see standard play, but I'm not exactly sure where its home is right away. And it is worth mentioning, it gets got by Elspeth Conqueror's Death, also pretty good with Elspeth Conqueror's Death. If there's an argument for Teferi seeing play right away, it's probably that +1 allows you to discard other creatures and planeswalkers and then reanimate them with Elspeth Conqueror's Death. And Elspeth Conqueror's Death is like the centerpiece of most control style decks at the moment, in mid-range style decks. So that is a +2 Teferi compared to some of the other planeswalkers. On the other hand, I think one place where Teferi is really going to shine, more so than most planeswalkers, is in Commander decks. If you look at planeswalkers in Commander, normally they're not that good because you have 3 opponents, presumably, that can attack them and kill them. so it's hard to get that much value out of them, but being able to activate Teferi on each player's turn in a four-player game, that means in theory you could play Teferi on your turn, tick up during your turn, tick up, four times in one turn cycle, which is absolutely insane, so you can rush to that ultimate very, very quickly. I think it gets even more value if you're playing a blue deck that cares about the graveyard, maybe Emery or Jace, some way where you're using your graveyard for value. But overall, I think Teferi Time Raveler, I actually really like this card. I was, like I said, very worried when I heard Teferi theme set, but after seeing Teferi Master of Time, my initial reaction is, this is a fine card. It's even probably a fun planeswalker to have around, seems very sweet in Commander, seems good enough to see play in Standard, but I heavily doubt that this is going to be a card that, after 6 months, we're all like, oh my god, I hate Teferi, please ban it. I don't see that in Teferi Master of Time. Hopefully I'm not wrong, but I feel like this one might have actually hit the mark perfectly. Speaking of planeswalkers, we also got Liliana, Waker of the Dead, showing off one of the new planeswalker frames. I think each planeswalker in Core Set 2021 has three frames, a normal frame, full art frame, and then this kind of constellation-y style frame. So Liliana, Waker of the Dead, 4 mana, 4 loyalty, plus 1, each player discards a card, each opponent who can't lose is 3 life, negative 3, target creature gets negative X until undeterred, where X is the number of cards in your graveyard, and then negative 7, you get an emblem where at the beginning of combat on your turn, put a creature card from a graveyard onto the battlefield under your control, it gains haste. So Liliana, Waker of the Dead, kind of comparison-wise, the plus 1 is like an improved version of Liliana the Veil's plus 1. Everyone discards, but if your opponent's empty-handed, you get some damage, kind of making it like a rack-style effect added on as well. The negative 3, kind of like a souped-up necrotic wound that triggers on every card in your graveyard rather than just creature cards. And then the negative 7, it's kind of like a better God Pharaoh's gift if you get to ultimate. You get the creatures back, but you can get creatures from anyone's graveyard. So I think that Liliana, Waker of the Dead is actually a really sweet card. It'll be interesting to see where people can make it fit in Standard. This is another planeswalker that I don't think is busted. I think it's a fine card, it's a fun card, it's probably a playable card, but it does need a shell to make it work. Thankfully, we have a lot of ways to fill our graveyard in the Standard format. We got Mire Tritons, we got Cavalier of Thorns and other options available, so stocking our graveyard isn't that hard, and that's what Liliana wants. Plus Liliana can kind of support itself, we plus to discard, eventually get to that ultimate, start reanimating, and we have some other really good payoffs available in the format. Liliana seems right at home with something like Nethroi or even Eerie Ultimatum, so I think that Liliana, Waker of the Dead, it's not an overpowered planeswalker by any stretch, and it is somewhat narrow, most of its abilities caring about having cards or even creature cards in the graveyard, but it is fairly powerful. It does protect itself. The plus one, I think, is stronger than most people give it credit for. We've seen that with Liliana the Veil. Symmetrical discard can be really strong when your deck is built around it and your opponent's not. And then the emblem, the negative 7, is obviously going to win you the game over the course of a few turns, most likely, but just getting back a hasty creature from any graveyard for free is very powerful. So Liliana, Waker of the Dead, I think this card's sweet, and I definitely plan on building around it in Standard. Now that we've talked about the planeswalkers, we gotta talk about how we stop them, and that is Spark Hunter Masticore. So Spark Hunter Masticore, 3 mana, 3/4. Additional cost to cast it, you gotta discard a card, which is usually a downside, but can be an upside if you want a specific card in your graveyard or trying to maybe fill your graveyard for Liliana or something. It has protection from planeswalkers. You can pay 1 mana to ping a planeswalker and pay 3 to make it indestructible. So Spark Hunter Masticore is the next in a long line of Masticore creatures, going back to the original Masticore, which at its time was considered to be one of the best creatures that had ever been printed, and they all kind of have similar mechanics where they make you discard cards, they deal damage to things. Obviously, Spark Hunter is focused specifically on planeswalkers, and I think this card is actually very pushed. Just by the stats, a 3/4 for 3 mana, that is a very playable stat line. We see Brimass and Thrashing Brontodon and Kethis. That is on curve to above the curve, even by 2020 standards, and maybe even more so, considering Spark Hunter Masticore is colorless, so any deck can play it. So you get on curve stats, and then you get this great answer to all these annoying planeswalkers. Teferi Time Raveler, can't bounce it. Narset, can't kill it. Teferi Master of Time, can't make you phase it out, I guess. More importantly, 1 mana to ping a planeswalker means that if this sits on the battlefield, you can repeatedly just shoot down Planeswalkers. So this is a wonderful answer to Planeswalkers. And I think this card, it's a little meta dependent, but the stats are good enough that you can play it. Yes, discarding a card is sort of a drawback, but if you're worried about the Teferis and Narsets of the world, Spark Hunter Mastagore seems absolutely perfect for sniping them. In Standard, in Specific, I don't think it'll see much play in older formats. If it does, it'll be because it's in a deck where discarding a card is actually an upside rather than a downside, like turning on Madness or something. But this card seems like exactly the answer that we need to deal with annoying Planeswalkers like Teferi, which are running around in Standard. Next on our list, we have the return of Mangara, Mangara the Diplomat. And this card is pretty powerful, I think. So 4 mana, legendary creature in white, you get a 2/4 lifelinker that whenever an opponent attacks with creatures, if two or more of those creatures are attacking you or planeswalkers you control, you get to draw a card, and whenever an opponent casts their second spell each turn, you get to draw a card. So Mangara, it's a card that, as far as Standard is concerned, I don't know. Not super excited about what it can do. I think there are possibilities here as a 2/4 lifelinker. It seems like an insane sideboard card against decks like Mono Red that are naturally swarming with creatures. A 2/4 lifelinker, pretty good blocker. They have a hard time killing it. They need very specific removal that they usually don't have in their main deck, and they basically have to keep attacking you to do anything. So if you play Mangara and your opponent chooses not to attack because you have this 2/4 lifelinker that's going to draw you cards, you're kind of already winning. And if they do attack, well, you get to block with a 2/4 lifelinker and get to draw some cards, so you're winning that way as well. So I think that's the most likely home for Mangara in Standard, like sideboard card against Mono Red or other similar aggressive decks, where it's a good blocker on its own and will generate some card advantage. On the other hand, as far as just seeing widespread Standard play, there's some issues here. So Mangara is 4 mana, and it doesn't do anything right away. You gotta wait and hope your opponent attacks, hope they cast multiple spells in a turn. So a lot of times, Mangara's just gonna be a 2/4 for 4 with lifelink, which means it's very easy for you to spend 4 mana on this and have your opponent bounce it with Teferi and you get no value, or eat it with Elspeth Conqueror's Death, or kill it with Heartless Act, and you just get no value out of it. So because it doesn't do anything immediately, and because we have a lot of cards in Standard that punish cards like Mangara that don't do things immediately, I would be surprised if this was just a widespread main deck type card in Standard, but very good like mono red sideboard card, I think. On the other hand, there's a format where Mangara shines, and that format is almost certainly Commander. This card seems designed to fix some of White's problems in the Commander format. So in Commander, remember, you got 3 opponents most of the time. So that means you have 3 opponents that can be casting 2 spells in a turn, that can be attacking you with creatures each turn. So you're potentially drawing a lot of cards with Mangara, and it doesn't look super threatening. It's not one of those threats that's just gonna make your opponent kill you or even necessarily kill it. And no one's gonna choose not to attack ever because of Mangara, or choose to play 1 spell each turn in Commander. Like, that's just not worth it. Like, draw your card, move on with it, that's fine. No one's gonna play the Mangara attacks, which I think means Mangara is gonna see a lot of play, because if there's one thing that White is bad at, that is drawing cards. That's been an endless complaint about White in Commander. It just can't draw cards. That means White decks have to play, like, Endless Atlas, and Land Tax, and Mind's Eye, and these are fine options, but Mangara, the potential for this to come down and draw 2-3 cards in the first turn cycle, and potentially up to like 6 in the first turn cycle, that is absolutely insane. There is a ton of value that this provides as far as card advantage, and it's something that White decks are severely lacking. So I expect this to be an ultra staple in White decks and Commander. Like, if you're playing a White deck, I think you just play Mangara. There might be some exceptions if you're like a combo deck, or if you're built around a specific synergy, maybe like SRAM equipment, maybe you don't play it there. But really, I think a huge percent of White decks are going to play Mangara because they're starved for card draw, and Mangara is a great option for drawing cards. And I think there's actually a pretty realistic argument that Mangara might be the single best card to see print for White in Commander since Smothering Tithe, and that is high praise, because Smothering Tithe is off the charts good. So Mangara, I think this card is great. I don't think it's going to do a ton in Standard, maybe some sideboard play, but expect to see Mangara early and often at Commander tables. It's going to be all over the place in most white decks you face, and it's super good, and I'm super excited for it, because white does need to be improved in Commander. White is the worst color by a pretty wide margin, and the biggest reason it's the worst color is that it can't draw cards, and Mangara allows it to draw cards in a way that feels very white. Your opponent can choose not to attack you. They can choose to just play one spell each turn, and technically you never draw a card, although no one's really going to never cast two spells in a turn in Commander, so it fits the taxing theme of white. It's a way that white can draw cards that feels, to me at least, very white, and I think this card is going to be super great in Commander, and I'm excited to play it. We also got Double Vision, a pretty interesting red enchantment. So, 5 mana, whenever you cast your first instant or sorcery spell each turn, you get to copy it, and you can choose new targets for the copy. So, Double Vision, obviously, the easiest way to take advantage of this is to have instants, so you can cast spells on your turn and your opponent's turn, so you double up the value. So, in Standard, you get things like Opt and Thrill of Possibility and Thirst for Meaning. These cards are great with Double Vision, because you can cast an Opt on your turn, copy it, draw two cards, do some scrying, do it again on your opponent's turn, draw two more cards. That's a lot of value. And then cards like Thrill Possibility, especially good because you get around the drawback with the copy of having to discard an extra card with the copy. So I think that that's the easiest way to take advantage of it, play some instants. Although what I'm afraid of with this card, and I think probably the scariest thing you can do, is some sort of extra turn deck. Maybe it's win more there, but turning your time warps into time stretches, so everything you cast is giving you two extra turns. That is insane. I feel like if you're playing a turns deck and you tap with this and you cast a single extra turn spell, it's almost impossible that you don't win the game, getting two extra turns for every single time warp that you cast. So that seems like the most likely home for it. On the other hand, if you want to go full on Jake mode, there are some 10 damage bird spells out there. Searing Wind, Urza's Rage, Fight with Fire. Obviously, even if you don't damage your opponent at all and you stick a Double Vision, you cast any of these spells or kick any of these spells, you just 20 your opponent on the spot and win the games, which is probably more of an against the odds play, but still super hilarious if you pull it off. But that said, I don't think that Standard is the primary home for Double Vision. Again, this is a card that seems built for Commander. If you read the text, it's basically Kalamax, one of the most popular new commanders from Commander 2020, except in enchantment form, and you're not going to tap it, of course, because this is an enchantment, which means if you have a Kalamax deck, I think you just slot this into it, and that's probably true for other spell-copying Commander decks as well. You already have the support for something like Double Vision with your Seedborn Muse and your Wilderness Reclamation to untap all your lands so you can keep playing more and more spells churn through your deck. So easy inclusion in decks like that. I mean, Swarm Intelligence is probably a good comparison for Commander, and Swarm Intelligence, I wouldn't call it an ultra staple, but it is played heavily in the format. Of course, there's a drawback. Swarm Intelligence, it's more mana up front, but it copies every spell you cast. Double Vision's a little bit safer, only capping the first one each turn, but you get a big discount up front at 5 mana compared to 7 mana. So I would say Double Vision, janky fun in Standard, unlikely to be a top tier card in the Standard format, but definitely something that'll be fun and funny to build around. It can do some busted things when it goes off. On the other hand, in Commander, I think a lot of spell copying decks, Kalamax for example, but really anything built around slinging spells, casting lots of spells, is probably going to want Double Visions, because this is very efficiently costed at 5 mana. Even with the drawback of only copying the first spell each turn, it's not going to take you very long in Commander, maybe one time around the table to get your value out of this card and then some. And if it sticks around, you're going to quickly take over the game. Next on our list, we have another interesting mythic, Ran and Siri Inseparable. So, 4 mana and the Naya colors, 4/4 mythic. The big deal here is the creature type. Legendary creature, dog, cat. That's right, dogs are now an official thing in Magic. For years, cats have been getting a lot of support, but dogs have been getting the short end of the stick, being hounds, not having any real tribal synergy. Well, with Corset 2021, that is changing. Dogs are an actual thing in Magic, which makes me super happy because everyone knows dogs are clearly way better than cats anyway. So it's only fair that the best creature type would get some more support in the game. As far as the card itself, it's kind of a cool mashup of dogs and cats. Whenever you cast a dog spell, you get a cat token. When you cast a cat spell, you get a dog token. And then you can pay 3 mana and tap it to deal damage to any target equal to the number of dogs you control and gain life equal equal to the number of cats you control. So even though I'm mostly hyped about the dogs coming to Magic aspect of Ren and Siri, I think this card's actually pretty sweet. We do have a decent amount of cats in Standard, so casting cats to make dogs, that should be pretty easy. Kahira's, Ajani, Pride Mates, many of the Apex cycle, I think all of them actually, are cats, so there's plenty of cats running around. There's also a few dogs, well, presumably, I would guess that with this change, hounds are going to become dogs, which means all of a sudden Mawu, rather than being a hound, will be a dog, and same with Kunoros. So there will be a few dogs, plus I expect we'll get a lot of dogs in Core Set 2021 itself, so there probably will be enough support to build at least a casual Ren and Siri deck in the Standard format. On the other hand, if you go back through Magic's history, there are quite a few hounds running around, so there will be plenty of support for a Commander deck, and I think that is the most likely home for Ren and Siri. I expect this card to be an incredibly popular build around. Players love cats, players love dogs. Ren and Siri, stick them together. You can have your cake and eat it too in the Commander format. But mostly, still, I'm just super hyped that dogs are finally a real creature type in Magic. We also got Peer into the Abyss. So rumors were going around a little while ago from Mark Rosewater and his teasers about a card that says draw half your deck. Well, we found out what it is. Peer into the Abyss, 7 mana, sorcery in black. Target player draws cards equal to half of the number of cards in their library rounded up, and also loses life equal to half of their life total rounded up. So basically, for 7 mana, you draw half your deck, and you lose half your life. This reminds me a little bit of a mixture between like Cruel Bargain, Infernal Contract. These are cards that for 3 mana let you draw 4 cards at the cost of losing half of your life. On the other hand, it's also a little like Overflowing Insight. 7 mana, draw a lot of cards. How often is drawing 20 cards rather than 7 gonna be relevant? I mean, I guess it's somewhat relevant. Although remember, there is a pinch. There is definitely a pinch here. With Peer to the Abyss, you're gonna draw 20 cards, let's say. Are you gonna have the mana to actually cast all them or actually use them? So I actually think that, played fairly, I'm not sure how good Peer into the Abyss will be. Obviously, you could play it in, like, let's say Mono Black Devotion. You got Grey Merchants to recoup life. You got Tamarets. You could even play, like, Nyx Lotus to make mana. Like, you cast this, you're gonna draw, like, 20 cards in a typical game. What are you gonna do with them? Discard them to hand size, I guess? Play some of them? Get attacked back by your opponent after you go from 20 life down to 10 life? I think there is a concern that you just kill yourself. On the other hand, I love this card as a combo piece, and I can't believe I'm saying this, but Wizards, they printed a card that says target player draws half of their library, and I just want to target my opponent with it. I think that is the use of this card, and that's what I'm mostly excited about. We got Underworld Dreams in Standard. We got Obnixilus in Standard. These are cards that trigger whenever an opponent draws a card, so if you play any one of these, Underworld Dreams, Peer into the Abyss, targeting your opponent, it's a two-card combo kill. Yes, Peer into the Abyss is a lot of mana, but it doesn't seem that hard to pull off. We've already done this in the hard mode with, like, Smothering Tithe in emergency powers, trying to make the mana work. Peer to the Abyss not only gives us more redundancy in the emergency powers role, but it fits more naturally with the color. So maybe we can play like janky mono black devotion combo. Just Peer to the Abyss, Underworld Dreams, Nyx Lotus to make mana, get down our enchantment, cast Peer, kill our opponent on the spot. So as amazing as it sounds, I'm hyped about Peer into the Abyss, not so much targeting myself, although I'm sure I will do it because I love drawing cards, but targeting the opponent with Peer into the Abyss seems absolutely busted if you build around it, and like it could actually be pretty powerful. So super hyped for Underworld Dreams, Obnixilus, Peer into the Abyss combo.deck. Next on our list, we got an interesting enchantment, Teferi's Ageless Insight. So 4 mana, legendary enchantment. It's blue, and if you draw a card, except for the first one you draw, you just draw a step, you get to draw 2 cards instead. So we've already seen this effect before. It's essentially Elhemeret's Archive, except it's 1 mana cheaper. It doesn't do anything with life gain, and it's a blue enchantment rather than an artifact. Also shares some similarities to Thought Reflection, but Thought Reflection triggers on every card, so you double up your draw step too, when Teferi Ageless Insight does not trigger on your draw step. So, I mean, I could definitely see playing this in a lot of Commander decks. I like drawing cards. I play a lot of card draw spells, drawing 2 instead of 1. That technically makes it like a card draw spell in and of itself. So I don't think this is going to break anything or do anything super crazy, but I've definitely played Elhemeret's Archive in my day, and I could see Teferi's Ageless Insight filling that role, especially in Commander, and who knows, maybe some janky fun Standard decks as well. We also got Teferi's Tutelage, a new uncommon enchantment, and I'm hyped about this card for 2 reasons. So reason number one is, if you read this card, it says whenever you would draw a card, target opponent mills two cards. It actually says mill. If you look at similar cards in the past, like Sphinx's Tutelage, let's say, it's got the wordy route of getting to there. Whenever you draw a card, target opponent puts the top two cards of his or her library into his or her graveyard. Now we can just say mill, and players have said mill for a long time. Wizards has resisted making the change, but now mill is an actual keyword showing up on Magic cards, which is a great change. More importantly, in terms of gameplay, Sphinx's Tutelage is one of my literal favorite cards to build around. I love drawing cards, and Sphinx's Tutelage, and now Teferi's Tutelage for standard, it just rewards you for drawing cards. So all you gotta do to win the game with a card like Teferi's Tutelage is play a copy, maybe two copies, and then you just kind of draw cards until your opponent runs out of cards in their library. So I expect we will be playing some Teferi's Tutelage in standard. You even get a nice bonus that when it enters the battlefield, you get to loot. So if you have copies on the battlefield, additional copies will trigger them, start the building process. But really, milling being keyworded is awesome, and cards that reward you for drawing cards are some of my favorite cards to build around in Magic. So I expect we will be Teferi's Tutelaging on Budget Magic in the not-too-distant future. We also got Vino, Thorn of the Dusk Rose, and this card is pretty exciting. 3 mana, 1-3 Legendary Vampire Cleric. Whenever you gain life, target opponent loses that much life, and then you can pay 5 to give creatures you control lifelink until the end of turn. So Vino, it's essentially Sanguine Bond, except on a 3 mana creature. So on one hand, Vino is a Sanguine Bond that dies to creature removal. On the other hand, it's a Sanguine Bond that's only 3 mana and is also a legendary creature, which means you can play as your commander, which opens up some consistent combos in the format. So what do you do with Vito? Well, number one is the traditional combo with Sanguine Bond is Exquisite Blood. Exquisite Blood is like Sanguine Bond in reverse. Whenever an opponent loses life, you gain that much life. So if you get both of those effects on the battlefield together, and then an opponent loses life or you gain life, it starts this infinite damage loop. Like, let's say you have Sanguine Bond, Exquisite Blood, or in this case, Vito in Exquisite Blood, and then you gain a single life. You have a Soul Ward and you play a creature, it gains one life. That one life is going to make your opponent lose one life, which is going to make you gain one life, which will then make your opponent lose one life. That'll go on until your opponent dies. So that's the traditional combo with Vito. In standard, I think one of the easier ways to build around it is go with the mass lifelink plan. Vito gives lifelink itself. Sorin gives all yourself lifelink. Deafening Clarion can give all yourself lifelink. If you could build a big board of creatures, have Vito out, attack with those creatures. Sure, maybe some of them die in combat, maybe some of them get through, but that damage is gonna go through thanks to Vito and you gaining life with lifelink. So that's one simple way. You can also go a more combo-centric way, like for example, Kenrith. 3 mana, target player gains 5 life. That means if you have Vito out and you can activate Kenrith 4 times, you're going to gain 20 life. Your opponent's going to lose 20 life. You win the game. Obviously, you don't got to do that all at once, but life gain effects like that are pretty sweet. Also, Revival Revenge is potentially a 2-card combo kill. I don't think it works at every single life total. Like, let's say you're at 2 life and your opponent's at 20 life. That's not going to get the job done. But if your life total is high, your opponent's is relatively low, casting Revenge to double your life total and having your opponent lose half of their life is probably going to kill your opponent on the spot. If you want a more guaranteed combo, in Commander, Blood Tribute is game over. 6 mana, you can kick it by tapping a vampire, which Vito happens to be a vampire. Target opponent loses half of their life, rounded up, and then if it was kicked, you gain life equal to that way. So your opponent will lose half their life from Blood Tribute. You're going to gain that life, and then Vito will trigger to get rid of the other half of your opponent's life total. Also, one last thing about Vito that I wanted to make sure was clear, because it's kind of a weird rules thing that isn't all that obvious, but cards like Oketra's Last Mercy, Resolute Archangel, which reset your life total, like Oketra's Last Mercy, just as your life total becomes equal to your starting life total. So in Commander, your life total, if you're at 1, you go to 40. If you're at 20, you go to 40. If you're at Standard, if you're at 10, you go to 20. Whatever. Same with Resolute Archangel, sets your life back to your starting life total. These effects do work with Vito, and they do count as gaining life. Whatever amount your life total went up. So let's say you're playing Commander and you have Vito out and you're at 20 life and you cast Oketra, you're going to go back up to 40 life. You're going to technically be gaining 20 life, the difference between 40 and 20. Or if you're at 1 life, you would technically be gaining 39 life. Same with Resolute Archangel. So keep that in mind. Those effects do work. So I think Vito, Thorn of the Dusk Rose is absolutely sweet. The card has combos that we already knew about, like Sanguine Bond. It has new combos that haven't really been fully explored. It fuels itself by giving your team lifelink if you play it fairly, and it's a legend, so it could be your commander, which then makes your combos more consistent. So Vito, very spicy card. I think definitely going to see a lot of commander play. I expect it to be popular as a commander and in the 99. And there's some cool standard synergies and combos to try to pull off with it as well. So all around Vito, in my book, a home run from Core Set 2021. Next up today, we got to talk about reprints. So we've talked about a lot of sweet new cards, but one of the things that sets core sets apart from normal sets is it gives Wizards a home to reprint cards into Standard, also Modern and Pioneer, that those formats need that don't fit the flavor of the other sets that release every year. And we have been asking as a community for more good reprints. And I think that Wizards has, at least to some extent, heard our cries based on what we've seen already from Core Set 2021. So reprint-wise, number one, Ugin the Spirit Dragon returning to Standard. Ugin is currently a $60 card, which is absolutely insane. If you don't know this one, it's 8 mana. It can lightning bolt things with the +2. It can exile the board with its negative X. It wins the game with its ultimate. It is incredibly powerful. It's expensive, but it is off the charts powerful, up in the same area as like Karn Liberated, as far as really strong but really expensive colorless planeswalkers. As far as seeing play, Ugin, its main home right now is Modern Tron, tends to play it. I think that's really the only deck that plays Ugin as far as tournament play. Ugin also a good commander card, since it gives decks that don't traditionally have answers to any colored permanent, but any permanent answers to those. So I like Ugin as a removal spell in some like mono green or mono blue decks in Commander. On the other hand, as far as Standard, it's really hard to know what Ugin's future holds. Last time Ugin was in Standard, it was actually a kind of fringe card, but this was several years ago at this point, back during Fate Reforged era. So Ugin, it did see play, but it was pretty fringe. On the other hand, things are different today. We're in a Standard that has Arboreal Grazers, and Grow Spirals, and Uros, and Cavaliers. So in reality, getting up to 8 mana is probably 100 times easier today than it was back in Fate Reforged, when we didn't have just this abundance of really busted ramp cards. So I am legitimately fearful of how good Ugin is going to be in Standard. I think Ugin is going to be a very strong finisher for ramp style decks, and we got a lot of really good ramp decks because we got a lot of really good ramp. Also worth mentioning, even more scarily, that Ugin doesn't actually exile the lands that Nissa turns on because they technically don't have a color. So Ugin, $60 Mythic Rare reprint, demand from Commander and from Modern, and probably going to do some frightening things in Standard. We also got the most expensive core set reprint, I think, of all time, Grim Tutor. So Grim Tutor, 3 mana, search your library for a card, put it in your hand, shuffle, you lose 3 life for 3 mana. So it is an efficient tutor. This card is ridiculously expensive. It is currently $220. Although it's worth pointing out, the expense of Grim Tutor is because it's a portal card, so it is minuscule supply. There's just hardly any of them out there. In reality, Grim Tutor isn't really played anywhere, so I expect the price to drop severely. It is going to be a $5 card or something, maybe even less than that, because it doesn't see a lot of play. In Standard, is it better than Diabolic Tutor? Is it better than Mastermind's Acquisition? Maybe, I guess slightly, being 1 mana less is an upgrade, but you don't get to go from your sideboard like Mastermind's Acquisition. But cards like Diabolic Tutor, they don't traditionally see play in Standard, and I'm not sure if cutting a single mana and making you lose 3 life is going to change that. And it doesn't really see play in Commander as well. The place I am curious about Grim Tutor, and where we might see some waves made, would be formats like Modern and Pioneer. These are formats that don't really have an efficient tutor like Grim Tutor. They're formats that value efficiency, while in Standard, the difference between 3 mana and 4 mana isn't really that much. In a format like Modern, the difference between 3 mana and 4 mana is huge, so maybe combo decks like Ad Nauseam in Modern, or Inverter, yuck, in Pioneer will take advantage of Grim Tutor. So I think this is a card that it's exciting because it is ridiculously expensive, and it doesn't need to be expensive, and probably part of the reason it doesn't see more play in Commander is because it's just not accessible, and this reprint is going to fix this. Grim Tutor is going to be as close to free as you can be. It's going to be a very, very cheap card, but part of the reason the price is going to crash so much is because it doesn't really see that much play, and its current ridiculously high price is mostly based on scarcity, not based on demand. But still, even that aside, I am never going to complain when Wizards reprints a $200 card in a unlimited supply, standard legal set. That is exactly what we want Wizards to do with reprints. We also got Ruined Halo, and I'm actually pretty excited about Ruined Halo for Standard. This is not a super expensive reprint. It was at one point, but it's been reprinted in a Master set not that long ago. But 2 mana, double white, when it comes into play, you get to choose a card name, and you have protection from the named card. You can't be targeted by it, dealt damage by it, enchanted by it, anything with that name. So Ruined Halo, it's essentially a strong removal spell for enchantment decks in specific. That's the easiest home for this deck. We got a lot of support for Enchantress and Theros Beyond Death, the Constellation mechanics, Setessan Champions, Kalixes. Ruined Halo is going to be perfect for that archetype. When you think about how this card works, though, as a creature removal spell, it's only okay. It's good. Let's say your opponent's one with a massive Setessan Champion. You can play Ruined Halo. You name Setessan Champion. Your opponent can't damage you with a 10-power Setessan Champion. On the other hand, unlike a Banishing Light, or most traditional creature removal, the Setessan Champion's still going to be on the battlefield. So as your opponent plays enchantments, they are still going to draw extra cards. So it doesn't get rid of the creature altogether, but it does stop you from taking damage from it. On the other hand, Ruined Halo is another upside. It's a removal spell that also works with spells, and some of the top decks of Standard right now are built around killing you with one big spell, like Wilderness Wreck decks with Expansion Explosion, Cycling decks with Zenith Flare. Ruined Halo can name those cards, and it actually is a great way to stop those. Against a Cycling deck, if you play this on turn 2 and name Zenith Flare, your opponent can't target you with Zenith Flare, so you cut off their easiest way to victory. Same with Wilderness Reclamation. They can make all the mana, do all their shenanigans, but they can't actually target you with the explosion, so you're not going to die to it. So that flexibility is key. Even though Ruined Halo slightly worse than more traditional hard removal against creatures, it has the upside of flexibility where it works against spells as well, which I think is might make it a pretty important piece of removal suites in Standard. We also got another super expensive reprint, Azusa Lost But Seeking. So Azusa, you probably know what this one does. 3 mana, 1/2, currently around like $35, I believe. You can play 2 additional lands on each of your turns. So Azusa has one home as far as competitive play. It does see some commander play as well, but it has one main home, which is the Amulet Titan deck in Modern, where making extra land drops really, really scary with the bounce lands. It doesn't normally see play for value though, and I'm actually very curious about if and how much play Azusa will see in our current standard. So on one hand, we've had Azusa adjacent creatures, Dryad of the Ilsean Grove, Wayward Swordtooth. They haven't really seen a ton of play in Standard. Azusa similar, 3 mana, extra land drops. Of course, the upside is you can make 2 extra land drops, which is powerful. Downside is you're getting a much worse body that dies to things like shock. On the other hand, you can have some insane starts with stuff like Azusa. Let's say you're playing one of those decks that has like 29 lands or something ridiculous. Turn 1, Arboreal Grazer, extra land into play. Turn 2, Azusa, off your normal land drop, 2 more lands. You're going to be up to like 6 mana on turn 3, which is absolutely bonkers. So there is some explosive ability here to develop your mana base. The other issue is we got a ton of ramp in Standard. And this is where I think I'm a little skeptical that Azusa will see play. We have Arboreal Grazer, we have Grow Spiral, we have Uro, we have so much ramp that essentially doesn't die to removal. And Azusa, to be fair, as long as you hit your land drops, it does not die to removal. But are you going to choose to play a 1/2 that lets you make extra land drops if you have them in your hand over a Grow Spiral, which worst case it draws you a card, over an Uro, worst case it draws you a card, and eventually, best case, it comes back as a 6/6 that draws you a ton of cards? I think there's actually, in some ways, too many busted ramp spells in our Standard format, which makes me wonder if Azusa might get pushed out, even though it can be very powerful in the right deck, just because there's so many good options available. Regardless, Azusa, it sees Commander play, it sees Modern play, it's very expensive, and it needs to be reprinted, so we have a $35 card that's going to be at rare in Corset 2021. Obviously, the price is going down, but that's what we want, so another great reprint from a value perspective, even if Azusa ends up being more fringe in Standard than a staple. We also got the return of Baneslayer Angel. So Baneslayer Angel, this has been in standard a bunch of times. It's a great big lifelinking creature. Not super expensive because it's been reprinted a couple times, but still very iconic. 5-mana, 5/5 flying, first strike, lifelink, protections from demons and dragons. Kind of comparable to Lyra. That's kind of the easiest comparison. Although important to point out, Baneslayer is not legendary, so you can stack up multiples on the battlefield. And in our current standard format, I think Baneslayer Angel, it has one job. It could show up in control decks, although because cards like Teferi and Elspeth Conqueror's Death are so popular, in Baneslayer, it doesn't do anything right away. You gotta kind of like play it and untap with it and have it not get bounced or killed or exiled. That is a big drawback for a 5-mana creature, so I'm a little skeptical it's gonna be like an ultra staple just based on what our metagame looks like. On the other hand, Baneslayer is one of the best cards in all of Magic that you can play against an aggro deck. If you are playing a slower deck, a mid-range deck, a control deck, having some number of Baneslayers maybe in your main deck or at least in your sideboard is going to be your best way to just stick it to mono red or gruel aggro. Once Baneslayer comes down, those decks really, really struggle with it. With 5 toughness, they basically can't kill it. They need multiple removal spells. Their creatures can't attack through it. So I think that's Baneslayer's primary role. I would be surprised if Baneslayer was just like a 4 of main deck card. However, I do think it is going to be a key sideboard card for mid-range and control to fight against aggressive decks in the format. Finally today, in terms of reprints, we got Containment Priest, and oh my goodness, I am so happy. Out of all the reprints, this might be the one that I think is going to have the biggest impact on gameplay across formats. So an innocent little 2-mana 2/2 with flash, but it says if a non-token creature would enter the battlefield and it wasn't cast, exile it instead. So what do you do with Containment Priest? And let's start with standard and why this card is a huge deal. Even though Agent of Treachery is out of the format, thankfully, if you look at the list of things this hits on, Luca can't cheat creatures into play, they'll get exiled. Winota can't cheat creatures into play, they'll get exiled. Thassa can't play creatures. Cauldron Familiar can't come back from the graveyard. Yarya can't play creatures. Garuda can't do its janky reanimation combo. That is a huge list of the most playable cards and decks in standard that get absolutely wrecked by Containment Priest. And thanks to Flash, you can get the blowouts. You can let your opponent attack with Winona even, flash in Containment Priest with the triggers on the stack, or activate Luca, flashing it with the trigger on the stack. So with standard, Containment Priest, it hits on a lot of really important stuff and gonna be a really big deal for the format. Also important, the card hits on a lot of stuff in Modern, and this is a card I've asked for Modern for a long time, but Containment Priest stops Neoform, getting Grizzlebrand on turn 1, and winning the game. Eldritch Evolution, Court of Calling, dredge cards like Bloodgast, Narcomoeba, other reanimation-style decks like Goryeo's Vengeance, Through the Breach, Aether Vial, the list is absolutely epic at what Containment Priest kills. So I am ridiculously excited for Containment Priest to come and make its presence felt in Standard, in Modern. It hates on things we want to hate on, which is fast cheat things into play decks, which have always been a big part of Modern and have recently been taking over Standard as well. So hopefully Containment Priest will go a long, long way towards solving that problem. Amazing reprint for Core Set 2021. Last but not least, couple of lower rarity reprints. Kyurian Dryad downgraded from rare, a fun like spell slingery, a grow style card where if you play it and cast a bunch of cheap spells, it can get big. Torbod's Crypt for graveyard hate. Fierce Empath, I'm glad Agent of Treachery's banned. Don't want to see that. Tutor up Agent of Treachery is another way to cheat it into play. But fun with stuff like Yarok, where you can grab big creatures with Enter the Battlefield triggers and double it up. Anyway, oh my god, I think that brings us to the end of our daily Core Set 2021 spoilers for today. So what do you think? What do you think about this ridiculous? I will say, I know it is only day one of spoilers, but I'm going to plant my flag right now and say that when all is said and done, we're going to look at Core Set 2021 as maybe the best core set of all time, and I think even more likely, at least the best core set of the Black Border core set era. So I think this set is already looking off the charts, but what do you think about the cards? How do you combo with Vito? What about Teferi and Liliana? How big of a deal are the reprints? What is Ugin and Azusa and Containment Priest going to go to standard? What about mill being keyworded now? How can we mill people out with Teferi's tutelage? Rin and Sari, what about dogs being an actual creature type? Baneslayer Angel back, all the lower rarity stuff. Oh my goodness, $200 Grim Tutors. I don't know what else to say. Let me know what you think in the comments. Thanks so much for watching. I will be back tomorrow with more Corset 2021 preview. So until then, have a wonderful day, and I will talk to you soon.
Thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed it, help us out by clicking that like button down below. And to keep up on all the latest and greatest, click that subscribe button. And don't forget to hit that bell icon to get alerts whenever we have new videos. And if you want to, check out some of our other sweet videos here and here.